Όντως εντυπωσιακό το μέλλον. Και όσο είμαστε ακόμη στο μέλλον, η επόμενη ομιλία μας έχει να κάνει με το ποια είναι τα επαγγέλματα του μέλλοντος και ποιες είναι αυτές οι δεξιότητες οι οποίες στο μέλλον θα ορίσουν κατά πόσο είμαστε ανταγωνιστικοί. Οπότε θα ήθελα να παρουσιάσω τον Steve Bainbridge, ο οποίος θα μας παρουσιάσει ένα μέρος της έρευνάς του που έκανε για το Σέντεφοφ. Λοιπόν, για τις εξελίξεις στην αγορά εργασίας σε σχέση με την Ελλάδα και την Ευρώπη. Η επόμενη ομιλία θα είναι στα αγγλικά, οπότε αν κάποιος από εσάς θέλει τη μετάφραση, μπορεί να επικοινωνήσει μαζί μας μετά τη λήξη του Toolbox Conference για να του στείλει με τη μετάφραση. Αυτά από μένα. Προχωρώ.
Thank you for that. Very warm welcome. I should leave now, probably. It's actually lunchtime, and when I was in your position, I always felt more hungry when some fat old guy in a suit and tie would get up to speak. But I will try to talk to you for the next 10-15 minutes about the way that the labour market is changing, and perhaps try and give some context to some of the other discussions that you have had already today. I will cover 6 points, so as I go through them, you can tick them off and think there's not much longer left. And I will go through them each one by one. I apologize for speaking in English, but trust me, it's better than my Greek. My accent is bad enough in English, you can only imagine what it would be like in Greek. But the slides are in Greek, so hopefully that will also help to get some of the points I want to make across. First point, technology is changing the nature of work, but not the demand for people. There is considerable fear that technological advance is killing jobs. A study in the United States in 2013 concluded that almost half of the jobs in the United States could be at risk of being replaced by machines over the next 10 or 20 years. And it is unlikely that the picture is very different in Europe. But the fear of technology replacing jobs is not new. In 19th century England, the Luddites smashed machines because they were afraid of job losses in the textile industry, almost 300 years ago. But 300 years of evidence so far points to the fact that technology changes work and its nature, but actually, in the end, creates more jobs than it destroys. Before the economic crisis in 2008, you remember those days? The European Union was enjoying its highest rate of employment ever. Two-thirds of the people who could work in the European Union were working. Job growth is also returning to the European Union. And by 2020, there will be as many jobs, as many people employed in the European Union as a whole as there were before the crisis. In Belgium, Germany, France, Austria, Finland, Sweden, and the UK, employment is already higher than it was in 2008, despite the advance of technology. The thing about technology is that it is good at replacing routine tasks. But it is important to remember that there is no direct link between skill level and routine. Low-skill production line manufacturing jobs may be routine and can be replaced easily by technology. But the internet is already replacing many medium-level clerical jobs as people make purchases and applications online. Most times at the airport, you already have your boarding pass and you go straight through. You no longer go to someone at the counter to ask for your boarding pass and for them to tell you you can't take that bag onto the plane. These jobs are being replaced. At high skill level, technology is also replacing jobs. Airplanes without pilots, drones, are already more widely used than cars without drivers. And most routine financial trades are processed by technology without human intervention. And this trend in the loss of routine jobs will continue, but new jobs will be and are being created. Technology can send messages, but it cannot communicate. You have to create the message. Someone has to create the message before it can be sent. I'll use an example of how these things work, how these trends have worked, from my own country, the UK. I am old enough to remember in the 1970s when banks introduced ATM machines. They thought that this was a great way to cut costs. They closed branches, they got rid of people, and they reduced the hours that the banks were actually open. Now, 30 years, 40 years later, cash machines are everywhere. You can access your account through the internet from wherever you are. But in the UK, more bank branches are open for longer, even on Saturdays, and the banks employ more people. They employ people no longer to give you money or take your money. They employ people to give advice. They employ people to give advice about loans and mortgages. And so the nature of the job has changed, despite the advance of technology. The thing is, who consumes people? There is a story that I like where about a factory owner, a car factory owner, and a trade union leader going around the factory. And the factory there is all automated. The cars are being manufactured by robots. And the factory owner says to the trade union leader, "How many of these robots are you going to call out on strike?" And the trade union leader replies, "How many of these robots are going to buy your cars?" It is people who consume. And the march of technology is accelerating the shift of jobs into services. And most people will be working in services that indirectly or directly improve their clients' quality of life, either in the areas of health, social services, tourism, education, or other types of services. These are jobs where people deal with people. Now, in a world where your job is to deal with others, it is people, you, and the people that you employ, or will employ, that provide the competitive edge. Price and quality will always be important, but increasingly they are expected. The edge of competition is in the quality of the service that only people, not machines, can deliver. And studies show, even at the basic level of supermarkets or mini markets, that people are prepared to pay more for quality service and positive interaction. Fast food restaurants, such as McDonald's, they don't need people at the counter anymore. I was in one in Paris. You put in what you want, and you go to the other end, and out it comes. Supermarkets don't need people to operate the checkouts. Many supermarkets already have places where you can check out yourself. Technology can do these tasks. But jobs in fast food restaurants, jobs in supermarkets still exist, largely because people want and need to interact with other people. Supermarkets without people would soon lose customers to competitors who have retained a human face. The McDonald's I was in Paris, had a huge queue. People were not using the technology because they wanted to speak to the nice person in front to tell them they wanted burgers and fries. People matter. Manufacturers and service providers increasingly compete by developing personal relationships with customers. A friend of mine recently made a $15 million deal for his company, not because the products of his company were better than those of his competitors, but because he knew the customers and he knew what they wanted. The competitive edge there was trust. And so it's people dealing with people. People make businesses competitive. So if people make businesses competitive, what skills are in demand? Well, the jobs of the future will require people to think, decide, organize, and communicate, and to deal with not very non-routine tasks. Foreign languages, an area where Greece is particularly strong, and advanced reading skills are required not only by professionals, but increasingly by shop assistants, waiters, waitresses, many of whom traditionally are not highly qualified. Workers will need to be adaptable to learn new ideas, methods, or techniques, not least because technology is changing how we work. In the future, work will be more networked, less rigidly focused on a specific workplace or around fixed working hours. The human cloud means people can work any hours, anywhere in the world, provided they deliver on time. I don't know if many of you have been to London lately, but London is increasingly becoming a 24-hour city. It is estimated that half of the people travelling on the buses during the night hours, the early morning hours in London, are either travelling to or from work. Now, all employers will be seeking these skills, organisational skills, communication skills. They will want them to different degrees, but they will apply at all levels, from the very lowest to the very highest. These skills will be required. Look at today's agenda for the conference that we have. Much of today's discussion is about behavioural skills, in particular about creativity, about the best use of the technology, and about changing approaches and changing thinking to give yourself that edge that just cutting the costs will not deliver. So, where will you find those skills? Where are they? Well, in Greece, the level of educational attainment is rising. Let me show you this chart. By 2020, in Greece, around 43% of 30 to 34-year-olds will have high-level university equivalent qualifications. That is above the EU's target of 40% by 2020. So, zito y alala. On current trends, around half of 30 to 34-year-olds in Greece will have a university-level qualification by 2025. 10 years. But despite rising educational attainment and high unemployment, employers say they cannot find these skills. A Manpower survey in 2013 found that, on average, across 17 EU member states, including Greece, more than 25% of employers said they had difficulties finding the people that they want. But a closer look at these figures shows that most recruitment problems are not due to a lack of skills. Employers offer poor wages and poor working conditions. In addition, they follow inefficient recruitment and training strategies. Employers tend to overlook possible candidates, including older workers. And this is important, as the EU labour force is changing. Although there will be more younger people who are highly qualified, there will actually be fewer of them. And this trend in Europe is mirrored by Greece. Between now and 2025, there will be a significant increase in numbers of people in Greece's labour force aged over 45 years old. And in contrast, younger age groups are projected to fall substantially due to a falling birth rate and emigration. But despite the need for behavioural skills, recruitment decisions are made on other criteria. For example, employers want staff who are adaptable, but then don't look for it when they recruit, especially when unemployment is high. With lots of highly qualified job candidates available, employers will prefer to wait for the perfect candidate. They want someone who was doing exactly the same job before, preferably using the same machine or same program or selling the same goods. They do not exist. They're not there. Older people tend to be more mature with more developed behavioural skills, but tend to be rejected in favour of younger people. So when recruiting, be careful where you look and what it is that you wish for. Oh, there we go. You have to invest in your skills and those of your staff. Training can take time as well as money, but it is one of the most important investments you can make. All businesses need to deal with people, not just clients, staff or people too. At a time of high unemployment, where labour is plentiful and cheap, it is easy but a huge mistake to underestimate the value of people. Businesses are more efficient and competitive if relations between management and staff are good and there is trust. And even the latest technology is at best useless and at worst dangerous in the wrong hands. Nobody can do more damage or good for your company than you yourself or the people you employ. In 2013, the Manpower survey that said that people couldn't find the skills they were looking for also found a quarter of employers complaining about a lack of experience and work attitudes of young people. But it's very difficult for young people to acquire work attitudes if you can't get any work experience. And so you have this constant cycle of people not being able to get a job because they can't get work experience, and no work experience because they can't get a job. And it is a huge and enormous waste of talent. And I would suggest to you, when you think about yourselves, think about people that you may take on in the future, look for not the specific skills, look for the behavioural skills. Look for talent that you can develop. Look for potential. Look for people you can trust. Look for people who will be adaptable, because these people will learn the rest, not just immediately, but also in the future. If you can, no matter how small your firm is, engage with vocational schools, TAFEs, and universities, and if possible, provide training placements. They will improve young people's job readiness and enable employers to acquire necessary work-related skills. They will give you an opportunity to find
good people, and also keep you up to date with developments in the education sector. But it is important to pay. People are like everything else. You tend to get what you pay for. Studies show education and training have social as well as economic benefits. Society as well as the economy benefits from more educated people. This applies to firms in the micro. Training can not only make people more productive, but also more loyal and actually more committed to their employer. It doesn't always work. There's always the risk that people will leave. But then again, expensive technology also breaks down and sometimes doesn't work. So in conclusion, those are my 6 points. Technology is great for routine tasks, but people make the difference. Technology cannot do what we do. And to be perfectly honest, there's no signs for the next generation that it will be able to. A more highly qualified but older labour force, which is also incidentally your market will be older but better qualified in Greece, require changes in how we look for and find the talent that we want. And don't neglect the skills of yourself or of those who work for you. Thank you very much.
Έτσι μιλάω και εγώ αγγλικά. Έχει κάποιος κάποια ερώτηση, την οποία μπορείτε να κάνετε και στα ελληνικά, ναι.
Ερωτικά στα ελληνικά. Εάν υποκλήσεις το εργατικό δυναμικό σου σαν επιχείρηση, θα αποδειχθεί θανάσιμο και αν ναι, αυτός ο καρκίνος πόσο θα εξαπλωθεί μέχρι να τελειώσει την επιχείρηση ορισμικά.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
If you have a company,
yes,
and you won't give knowledge and power, and if you won't care about your people, how long will this cancer take to expand and then destroy your company?
Not very long. Not very long. I have seen companies, and also it's also on different scales as well. It's not just small companies. It's big company. A small company can fold overnight. If it upsets its major customer or whatever else, it can finish. I've seen this happen. Small companies that are very dependent on one particular client, they don't manage to do something, they're not able to resolve the problem, or the client is not treated the way they think that they should be, and they're down to finish. It also happens with big companies with a major decline. In the 1980s, General Motors decided to get rid of as many staff as it possibly could. It would put in robots to build its cars. Toyota took the opposite decision. Toyota decided not to have to combine technology with workers' skills in small teams. The problem for GM was, if one part of the process, one part of the technology broke down, it closed the entire assembly line. Whereas if there was a problem in Toyota, it was much more localized and people could work around it. Which is now the most successful car company. People matter. And they, as I said before, you're quite right, they can destroy your business very quickly or they can create it.
Can I ask something? Is it more preferable to invest on a person that gets along with your clients at 90% of them in the best way, but 10% will hate that person completely? Or is it more preferable to invest on a person that gets along in a medium way with everyone? I mean, the position right now to employ one of these people, and I already have both of these types, and I still haven't decided which one is better.
I know, it can be a difficult decision. I think it has to depend also how important those 10% are to your business.
The point is that the 90% are so fond of this employee which is, I think, it's very important because all of these 90%, of course, is a much bigger percentage, but it's also that they love that person. It's not just a medium of relationship. They may go to a particular place just for him.
Right. Well.
So you have the 10% that hate him,
yeah.
Or the 90% that completely love him.
Well, yeah, and you can't please everybody all of the time.
Yes, you cannot have. Yeah.
It's also it's a case of which person, like anything else, will create most value for your organization now and in the future. It's also not just about the now, but also about the potential. If you have someone who is able to create value for your company now, for the vast majority of your customers, right, and will create that value in the future, that is a very important asset. If you feel that someone else who has not necessarily got the same gifts for a particular segment of your clientele, but has the potential both to keep that business and develop more business overall, then that's the decision. The criteria is who is going to create most value for you now and in the future.
I guess the 10% is much less than the 90%.
It is, but will you lose the 90% if the other person goes? Are you likely to lose customers if the other person goes? This is another issue. If you're likely to lose customers, that's another issue.
Yeah,
that person is important to maintain.
Relationships.
Yeah.
I'm more on this section.
Yeah.
Yes, but this 10%, isn't it big enough to take the risk as well, to hire someone who's...
It could be. I mean, I.
It depends on the person.
It depends on the person. It depends on how your company is developing, how you see it developing, who your clients are, how you could develop your market. Who will create most value for you?
Yeah. Thank you.
Hi. I'm just wondering. Most of the times, it's very difficult to foresee that good behavior skills, because you said that businesses should invest on behavior skills, right? But how are they supposed to do it? I mean, most of the times, people get to be evaluated by a CV or an application or a cover letter, perhaps. But it's supposedly theirs, but maybe it's not. And it's something that they should foresee, I think. I mean, it's something that they cannot take, you know, it's not information that they take in hand when they get to choose someone. How are they supposed to get, let's say, familiar to this idea and get to do it, like, in action? Like,
yeah.
The Skype interviews are also trending, but still, it's not very... You know, it's not very easy.
No, I agree with you. This is actually also a problem even for many, many big companies. Many big companies use technology to filter out job applicants. And they filter them, and you cannot assess behavioral skills. A computer can't do that yet. It can't say how reliable you are, how nice a person you are. It can't do that. But I think the key way of how to do it, there are a couple of approaches that can be taken. First of all, you must have a judgment criteria. You must have a criteria for deciding what qualities you want for that person. And what I'm saying here is often the criteria that we set is not the criteria what we want. We think experience is going to be exactly what we want, but it isn't necessarily. We want potential. So you need to be clear about what sort of the skills, the priorities, the most important things are. And if they are behavioural, then that's what you should be looking for in the interview. You can, there are also interview techniques, which are largely competence-based, where you give people scenarios and you ask them how it is that they will deal with those scenarios, how they have dealt with particular situations in the past. And on the strength of those answers, you can see how they handled things, what they did, how they organized, how they decided, how they communicated. So there are interview techniques that you can use as long as your criteria is correct. And there's always trial periods, which is another way that a lot of firms, they do internships. The problem with a lot of internships is they don't pay, so they only get certain groups of people. But there are also ways, trial ways of practicing, of giving people situations in which to deal with. So the criteria needs to be right. There are interview techniques to support recruitment on behavioural standards and also trials. Have you had enough?
Just one more.
Oh, okay. Yeah? Which one? There or there? Yes.
You talked about investing in your skills and those of your staff.
Yeah.
This means a bit of training. Should this be part of the working hours? And what do you do if an older member of staff or even a younger member of staff is resistant to training?
Yeah, this is also some of the problems. What we found in our studies is that the timing of the training sometimes is not necessarily the factor that prevents people going on it. The important part is that it needs to be at least in part employer sponsored. And also it needs to be at a time which is convenient. And this is sometimes a problem. So it may be convenient for someone to pursue it outside work. It may, because of family commitments or whatever else, it may not be. But the point is, as long as the employer is prepared to sponsor that training and to organise it, then the studies show that people will go on it and it does pay dividends. The other problem with older people is that older people tend to be reluctant, especially if they feel they're going back to school. They don't like going back and sitting in a classroom or being spoken to or lectured to or having to do things like that. And so it tends to be different type of pedagogy that you need to use for older workers. And again, that comes from talking to them to try to lower their resistance to how they feel that they could learn. Also, people get a little bit concerned because if you say you have to go and do some training, do some learning, they sometimes feel that, well, I'm not doing my job well enough, and so this is the first step in getting rid of me. And that's another psychological issue to overcome. It needs to be seen that it's assurance and it is an investment of confidence in that person. And then sometimes you can overcome the resistance.
Στην Ελλάδα έχουμε μια πολύ συγκεκριμένη κοινωνική τάξη, τους νέο ανέργους. Πώς μπορείς να εμπνεύσεις έναν νέο άνεργο να αναπτύξει behavior skills?
It is very difficult in English because the labour market is very, very segmented in Greece. And there's a tendency to link a specific qualification to a specific job, and if you haven't done that, right, then you can't do this. The only way that that can be changed is through attitudes, through the attitudes of employers, through your attitude. If you are prepared to explore the potential of somebody to do a particular job, even though their studies are not specifically linked to that, then you focus on the behavioural aspects rather than the educational experience. And that is only an attitudinal change can bring that about. And it is difficult. It is difficult in Greece, I know. There's a lot of protectionism that goes on where people keep other people out. And the only way that that can change is through changes in attitudes of employers. And employers are actually doing themselves a disservice by narrowing the talent pool from which they can draw down. So it's a case of having a mind that's more open. Okay? Are you done now?